Thank you, Dave. So let's crack on. We do have some slides, 321 more or less, to get through. So this talk consists out of five topics. We'll be talking, the first talk will be about from Guy. We'll talk about active streams that we announced this morning. Then in the middle, I will talk about Redis Search, Redis Graph, and Redis Time Series. And then at the end, Sharon will once again come on stage to talk about Redis AI, but then mainly about the integrations and also the performance benchmarking of Redis AI. But before we start, I wanted to give a shout out to the people from Hashton who've developed Redis Insight. So prior to Redis Insight, it was RDB Tools once Redis Labs acquired it. And I wanted to do a special shout out because they're effectively Bengalurians, not just a company in India. They're from your hometown. Well, we'll keep on developing this tool, and most importantly, it's free. And I want you to all to go and, if you didn't download it yet, to go and give it a try. Effectively, what we try to achieve with Redis Insight is we try to help you through all the stages of your development lifecycle. So if you, for example, have an inception ID, you want to try something out quickly, you can use Redis Insight. Where you're debugging, building your application, you have the slow lock, monitoring applications within Redis Insight. And then when you productionize it, you also have like memory analysis tools available to help you through and build your application. There will be a couple of demos, and there's also a second link where you can actually follow the demos. And with that, I hand it over to Guy Benoche, who's part of the ActiveActive team, or the conflict-free replicated data types, and he will talk about ActiveActive streams and how they achieve building that.
Now?
There you go.
Nice. Okay, so active streams. Iftach mentioned it for a second in the keynote, and he said it's complicated, and now we're going to talk about why it's so complicated. First of all, I will give a short introduction to Redis streams, just so everybody who doesn't know it will know what it is, and then I will talk about CRDTs and the active, and eventually I will talk about how we combine both of them together. Well, first, Redis Streams is a data structure that was first introduced in version 5.0. It's basically an append-only list that gets entries that are kind of hash-like structures. Each entry has a unique ID, and the IDs have to be monotonically increasing. The data may be accessed directly by XRead, XRange, or may be distributed to consumers that are part of consumer groups. Each stream can be actually processed by multiple consumers. Active. The geodistributed database system, what we call active, multi-master, that we have in Redis Labs is actually, to be honest, is an amazing product. The best engineers that we have work on it, and I've been enjoying every second in the last 3 years working about this in this project. It's basically based on CRDTs, which is conflict-free replicated data types. What it actually means, those data types were mathematically designed to avoid conflicts, which means that simultaneous write operations will not produce any conflicts whatsoever. Okay, so let's talk about how we combine the two together, what are the problems and the solutions. First of all, there are two major inherent problems with combining a geodistributed system with streams. First of all, it's monotonicity. Monotonicity is a kind of a problem, as you can see in this following example. Let's say one of the regions, currently, the current situation is the highest ID is 80. One of the regions may add ID with 100 to the stream. Before this information is propagated to any other regions, a second region adds an ID of 90. That means that any client on region 1 that uses XRead as an iterator might miss this entry. This is a major problem that is hard to solve. The second one is ID uniqueness. For example, both regions can just use the same ID with the xadd, and both of them can use xadd with the asterisk token and just happen to get the same ID. Both problems are very, very tricky to solve and almost impossible to solve in a lockless system. Okay, consumer groups. Another problem that we had is that in order to keep all regions aligned, ideally, we would like to replicate every XAC. But the problem is it's very costly by both network and memory to replicate each and every XAC. And basically, our guideline was that unlike XRead, we didn't want XRead group to miss any unacknowledged entry. The solution was that every region replicates the entry ID for which all preceding entries have been acknowledged. It's a best effort mechanism that has a limitation. The limitation is that in case of a network redirection, that means that a consumer that runs on region 1 goes to region 2, it may actually get an already acknowledged entries while issuing XRead group, but as I mentioned, it will never skip unacknowledged entries. ID uniqueness, or duplicate entry IDs. As I mentioned before, the issuing 2x ads on two regions with the same ID may actually result in duplicate IDs in stream, which may affect some commands such as xdel, xclaim, that will affect actually more than one entry. To solve this, we actually decided to create modes to xadd. We have three different modes. The first one is liberal, which is the same as Redis OSS, which actually allows duplicate IDs and all the problems that may result. The other one is strict. That means that xadd with the full ID format will fail, and xadd with the asterisk will actually generate an ID based on the Unix timestamp and the unique region ID, this is how we make sure there are no duplicates. And we have a third mode, which is semi-strict. It's the same as strict, but xadd with the full ID will not fail. But again, it might result in duplicate entries. The default mode is strict, because we don't want duplicate entries. And the limitation is that commands that succeed on OSS Redis, such as xadd with the full ID, will fail on active-active. That's it. Thank you.
Can you hear me? Hello. All right. Let's let's get started with the modules. So first up is Redis Search 1.6 that we released today. So first, just a recap. We all know by now it's a full-text search index. We can also do aggregations, and we can also do spell checking, etc. But what is an inverted index? We have a bunch of documents. We remove a couple of stop words. And then for each word in those documents, we effectively created a list that, of the documents that contain that word. And if you would do, for example, a union, or you want to search for two words, we do a union of the two sets of words that reflect those documents. Why? Well, world domination achieved, right? Or at least the start of it. So why would you use Redis Search? So there are two main reasons. There's speed and atomicity. So speed, why? It's much more recent than other available inverted indices. So we built from the ground up. It's written in C. We serve the data from memory. There are many reasons why it's very performing. The second reason to use it is because we can update your index atomically. So you can do a write into Redis Search, and then immediately, instantly afterwards, you will query it. It will have effect. Comparing that to other search database solutions, that's something not always present. There might be like near real time. So the headlines for this specific release is we will have a new low-level API. We have support for A-listing, several performance improvements, and we'll talk about benchmarking a bit later on. And we also have a new type of garbage collection, which I will touch upon. So the low-level API, why? Why did we do this? So the existing modules, the ones currently on the slides, are Redis Graph, Redis Time Series, and Redis JSON. They already have some built-in indexing. So in Graph, for example, we're using a skip list, or we were using a skip list, to be able to find certain nodes that have certain values on certain properties. In Redis Time Series, we were using sorted sets, because you had some labels there. You could specify, oh, I want to have all the time series that have a certain label value pair. And what could we do if Redis JSON had full-text search reports, right? What if a document store also had a full-text search index? I'll leave the imagination up to you what you can do with it. But next to that, we also wanted to avoid code duplication. If every module would be start to write its own secondary index, that would be quite inefficient. We also have already quite a good query language in Redis Search, so we thought to reuse it so that all modules could potentially use the same query language. And then also there are more advanced search use cases that we currently don't support. In, for example, Redis Graph, you could do graph-aided search. I will talk about that later on. But in Redis Time Series, you could do, for example, do prefix matching. Give me all the time series that match this prefix, for example. It's available in, to everybody, by the way, in C, and in, we also have Rust bindings. So Redis Graph is already consuming it. Redis Time Series is in development, and Redis JSON with the Rust, by the way, entirely developed in Rust, is already in preview. Next up is aliasing. So what is aliasing? So currently in Redis Search, you have physical indices. What you can do now is you can create also a logical index. So you can point the logical index to a certain physical index. And you can, for example, you can send your application code to configure it to point to the logical index, and then when you can load, for example, a second physical index, you can change just the logical index to point to the new physical index. And that's quite beneficial because your application has no downtime, right? So you don't have to reconfigure your applications to point to a new physical index. So who likes beers? Good. So we are in Bangalore, and I heard there are many microbreweries, so kind of like I have a couple of demos, but they're beer-oriented. Admittedly, I might have reinverse engineered the story, so I might have just Googled what to do in Bangalore, and I figured that out after I created the demo. But so for the demos, we will be using Redis Insight. So I have a couple of data sets loaded with those modules. And in this specific, in the first one, I will just go into Redis Search, and I have my beer index already loaded, so I can search for a beer that I really like, which is a Belgian one. Sorry for that. It's Orval. So you can see a couple of things here. We can do some we do some syntax highlighting, but we can also look at the data in different formats, or effectively also download it in different ways. So obviously, behind the hood, there are commands executed. We can now put we can create an alias on top of a certain index. And then when we would query that alias, we would effectively get the same results. So over to performance. So for testing, well, we already had a couple of benchmarks that we did, but now actually we want to have a proper framework to benchmark Redis search databases. It's a bit confusing sometimes in my head. So we introduced our own benchmark. It's based upon a time series benchmark. We kind of like forked it. But we added some tests. There's a multi-type ingestion test. There is a full-text search test. There's an aggregation test. And there are more to come. We currently have two data sets, but it can actually easily be extended to any other search database. So it's fully available to effectively to everybody. So we compared 1.4, which is the previous version, against 1.6. And so if you look at the full-text search query performance, we see an improvement in, from 48 to 63% in the throughput. And you can see at the bottom, effectively, which type of queries there are. There's a single word, a two-word union or, and then a two-word intersection. And we're adding more and more and more of those use cases. The latency is something similar, also up to 64% improvement. When we look at aggregation queries, we have 8 of those. I'm not going to list all of them. You can find them back on the repository. They're from easy to quite complex. We see 15% for the complex ones to 60% for the more easy ones, performance improvements in the throughput, and up to 73% in the latency. And then I have one more performance fact. It's about the garbage collection that I mentioned. Redis Search effectively is append only. We're going to, if we will update the document, we will mark it for deletion. And then there's a garbage collection process that is going to reclaim your memory afterwards. So originally it was effectively blocking the main thread on Redis and then doing some scanning, and I was going to update the memory and then effectively allowing you to do operations in between. In the new fork GC, we're effectively going to fork the process. We're going to do the analysis of what needs to be cleaned up, and effectively then only apply that to the main process. So in this test, we were inserting 10 million new documents in both the two new versions, and you can effectively see when they're all new, you can effectively see that it's quite relatively stable, the throughput. It's only when we start doing an update rate, we're going to do like 50%. So for each document, new document, we also update an existing document, that we can see that in the previous version, there is a performance degradation. While in the new version, we actually, there's a small one, but we effectively remain stable for the rest of the time. So because on the left-hand side, obviously, this garbage collection kicks in. So 8% for low update rate and up to 70% better performance for high update rate. We've got some integrations. You can work with the research in WordPress, Drupal, and there's some basic Spring integration. Where can I get it? You just take the name of the module, you add .io, and you can find all the documentations on how to get started. Redis Graph 2.0. It's been now a year and a couple of months since we went GA with the first version. So what is Redis Graph? Everybody kind of like knows, I guess, what a graph database is. So a graph is a conceptual model with nodes and relationships. We have a property graph, so you can put properties in both the nodes and the relationships. But we use effectively an adjacency matrix. So this one, by the way, all the rows and the columns represent all the nodes. And if there's a one, this represents the relationship between node one and node two. So why Redis Graph? So if you look at graph native databases, they either use adjacency lists or adjacency matrices. There are many graph databases, but some of them have just an API, a graph API on top of, for example, a relational database system. So, but in the graph native world, there are two ways to approach this. Redis Graph is the only one that uses an adjacency matrix. So it's a single data structure that effectively gives you the entire view of your graph. While if you look at the adjacency list, if you want to know if node 3 and 5 are connected, you first have to find node 3, and then you still have to traverse a linked list. On top of that, effectively, you can effectively parallelize the efforts of the computations with these matrices quite easily, even with OpenMP, which we're using in the latest version of GraphLoss. But also later on, we will work with GPUs. So once again, the reason is speed, performance. What did we add in Redis Graph 2.0? We added full-text search support. We changed the full graph response, which effectively enables visualization. We'll give a short demo about that. And we added significant amount of support for Cypher. So there's a long list of Cypher clauses. By the way, Cypher is an open standard for graph query languages, which is implemented by several graph database vendors. And we caught up, and we have now a substantial amount of support for Cypher. The list is quite long. I'm not going to go over all of them, because we're limited in time. But I want to give just one example. So it could be triadic closure. So you have a person A who's friends with B and C. Wouldn't it be a good idea to recommend B and C to also be friends, because they have a friend in common? So you're effectively trying to close the triangle. If you would like to express that in a Cypher query, it would look something like this. You're going to match a pattern B to A to C. And square brackets are relationships. You're going to say, well, you can do a filter, apply a filter on the node A. And then we're going to say where the pattern B relationship to C does not exist. So there are three things that we added here. We have undirected relationships, so we can query A to B to C without any direction, declaring any directions. We can also do parameterized queries. There's a name within between curly braces, which will allow us to do to cache your query plan and to become even faster. And we can do filtering, path filtering in a where clause. So there are quite a cool features to play with. We added Redis Graph is the first module to use Redis Search or to consume Redis Search. What does it enable, apart from many performance improvements if you do compound indexing or searches, for example? It adds graph-aided search. So in this example, we're searching for Yiftach, our CTO at Redis Labs. And you can also maybe see a tiny picture of me. So it's me who is logged in into LinkedIn, and we're going to score the search results based upon the connections I have in LinkedIn. And the closer they are towards me, the more relevant they're going to be ranked. So we're going to demo that with beers. So first off, I'm going to show you how a query looked like in the old version. It's not about the performance. If you would rerun this, OK, there we are. So what it effectively used to do, I'm just in this specific query, I'm going to match 10 nodes that have a label beer, and I'm going to return them. What we used to do we were going to create a tabular format where all the properties were on the nodes would be columns, and you could get a response from it. If we, on the same graph in Redis Graph version 2.0, would run this query, we would effectively get a graph response. So we're going to now return, by the way, full objects where the nodes have the labels, but also relationships will have a start node and an end node. And then we can effectively start to enable a graph visualization. Demo is a bit sleepy. So once we're there, we can effectively click on a beer, try to expand it. and it's going to load its neighbors and its relationships. So here's, for example, there's a likes relationship. This person likes this beer. She likes a lot of beers, as we can see. So I'm going to show you the first query here that I'm going to run and try to explain it to you. So we're going to call a stored procedure that is going to query the full-text search index, and we're going to do a fuzzy search on brew, on the brewery index. So we're going to search for a brewery, and we're going to then, once we found all the nodes that match this specific search criteria, we're going to match them against the pattern. We're going to say, hey, find a pattern where this brewery has certain beers that this person liked. And the more pods you can find, the higher you can put them into the ranking. So that's effectively what we can see in action. When I would execute this query, we can see that all these nodes, they will have some brew in it. And then the ranking effectively is based upon how many beers that person liked that were brewed by that brewery. So that's a form of graph-aided search. Also here, talking about performance, once again, we're comparing the previous version against the current version. A little bit about the query. The query is the K-hop neighborhood count query. It's a graph local query. You start with a single node represented here in black. You're going to count the number of nodes you can reach at a certain depth. So here the depth is 1, and we can count 2 nodes. The depth is 2, and we can count 3 nodes, right? So in our benchmark, we're doing this for 1, 2, 3, and 6 hops deep. And one can become quite a lot of nodes you need to count. I think effectively in 6, it's up to 80,000 nodes you need to count. So it becomes quite computationally expensive. This is how the query looks like. Comparing to the previous version, in throughput, we can see up to 3.7, and in latency, up to almost 4 times performance improvement. And we see the highest performance improvement in the highly concurrent and the most computational intensive queries. This is because, once again, we're using this OpenMP library, which allows us to do these matrix-matrix multiplications, the linear algebra underneath, in parallel. With that, I also want to state that we're introducing a new benchmark suite, where we're trying to get into the industry standard. There is an industry standard called LDBC. It's much more based upon academic research, much more substantial benchmark than the previous one we were doing. In version 2.0, we support the majority of the use cases, and that's from now on the benchmark that we will start using, and we will ditch the single case query, because you can see with the cipher query language, you can effectively make any potential type of query. We're partnering because we now have visualization support, so we have two partners, Linkurious and Graphelion. One is more aimed at fraud investigation and financial analysis, and Graphelion allows you to build applications. We're working on a GraphQL integration, and there's also basic Spring supports. Redis graph.io. Last one, Redis time series. So it's been GA now for almost half a year. So what is Redis time series? It's effectively it's like a time series database that allows you to manage time series. And what is a time series? It's a series of data points indexed in time the order. It might also sound silly to put in a Wikipedia quote. I'll get there. But what is most commonly is that a time series is a sequence taken in successively equally spaced points in time. And we're going to use that later on to do compression. I wanted to add 2 more points, that it's also typically append-only, and the definition of a sample is it's a timestamp and a value. So why Redis time series? Obviously, we saw the chart by Yiftach. There's an increase in demand, and if you look at DB engines, but also just there are more use cases. We know the application monitoring, we know the weather station, but there are many more. There is autonomous driving, there is smart homes, new retail solutions. All of these things are also creating time series data. So there's more and more time series data produced, so we need a good system to handle that data. Now, there are 2 problems typically with time series data and why you wouldn't put them in conventional database systems. There's scale and there's a toolbox for time series. So scale is the query pattern is typically high ingestion rate, and you don't query that often, but you have many samples that you need to receive. Conventional databases typically do the opposite. They're more on the read side, and you typically do less writes. Redis is very fast, so it can ingest lots of data very fast, and that's why there are also lots of people are using Redis for time series use cases with streams and sorted sets. For the toolbox, things that you need for time series are, for example, downsampling. You want to have retention. So downsampling, by the way, is that the further you go down past in the history, you want to have like a, you don't need all the raw data. You can do some aggregations. So you have less granular data. You want to have retention, but also aggregations, right? You want to have, for example, give me the standard deviation in a certain time window. And that is effectively what we wanted to do with Redis Time Series. We wanted to give you that toolbox to effectively, efficiently build applications for time series. In this version, we added compression. It's based upon the Gorilla paper written by Facebook. We also achieved a stable ingestion time. We did many performance improvements, and there's client support for most of the important programming languages. So the compression. The compression consists out of two parts. I'm not going to go through all the details, but I'll give it a try. So there's compression for the timestamp and compression for the value. And the compression for the timestamp is called double delta. So it relies upon the fact that there are equally spaced moments in time. Typically, you're going to receive a measurement every 5 seconds, for example. You're going to receive a temperature. And in between those timestamps, the delta is going to be 5,000 milliseconds in this example. And the delta of the deltas is zero. So if we apply some variable length encoding on top of that, if the double delta is zero, we're just going to store a single bit instead of 8 bytes for long. And then depending on the range where this double delta falls upon, we're going to have a header with a couple of bits, and that we're going to define how many bits we're going to use to put the double delta afterwards. So for the compression of the value, we're going to use XOR. So it relies upon the fact that your value typically goes gradually. It's not going to go abruptly. It's going to change in tiny bits. CPU measurement is not going, well, might. But the temperature sensor might just go slowly up, right? So you're going to go from 25 to 25 and a half. So if you do a XOR operation in between the two floating points, you would see that typically in between them, there's lots of zeros. There are lots of zeros before the meaningful data and after the meaningful data. That's what's going to be used to do also a variable length encoding. Just going to give this as a start. So if the XOR is zero, we're also going to put just a single bit. So in that case, if your double delta is zero and your XOR is zero, you have 2 bits out of 128, which is 98% is the maximum. Then there's the rest of the algorithm, which I'm going to skip in the interest of time. But we will blog about that. So, thirsty demo. So I'm going to show you once again using Redis Insight a demo. So what is happening now, I've found the breweries that I care about. I found the beers that I love. So I'm going to give a party. And in my party, I have 3 fridges. And I've put a temperature sensor in it. But also, I'm counting the number of beers that are in the fridge. So currently, all the fridges contain 5 beers. I'm just going to make some tweaks here. So you're going to change the axis. And then there's this very cool new feature that is allows you to catch up in time. So it's continuously going to pull the database again, and it's going to show you what is happening. Right, so now effectively I can select the fridge, the first fridge, and I can open the door. So what's going to happen when I open the door? The heat is going to get in, and we should see an increase in temperature in that specific fridge. So I might want to check, too, what's in the second fridge. I can make up my mind and can say, OK, fridge one, I'm going to take a beer. Maybe I will also take a beer for my friends. And then I go ahead and I close the doors. That concludes the thirsty demo. So here's some numbers about performance. Once again, we're using a benchmark suite. This is a public benchmark suite that is used by many other time series databases. But we produce 3 data sets. The first set, I'm pointing this out because it's kind of like I want to make a story around it. There is the first data set has a cardinality of 1,000 time series. The second one has 10,000 series. So what I want to prove here is when we look at performance is that even if we have more time series, the ingestion rate remains constant. And there's also a third data set, which once again has 1,000 time series, but it has more samples per time series. So what I want to prove here with that data set is the more samples we ingest, we keep effectively on having a constant latency in ingestion time. It's not going to become slower. There's not going to be the degradation if you have more samples within our time series. So here are the numbers comparing 1.0.3 to 1.2. So you can see that all the differences are quite small. So if you would compare 1.0.3 to 1.2, which is an uncompressed versus compression, we can effectively see that there is no or almost no degradation by enabling compression. If you look at the bottom, we're comparing the low to the high cardinality, and we can also see there's almost no degradation if you have a higher cardinality number of time series within our database. If you look at memory consumption, we can see up to 94% to 95% reduction. That being said, this is kind of like an artificial data set that we produced, but obviously the time series generated is going to have consecutive intervals in between the timestamps, so it's beneficial for the double delta, not for the XOR value. If you look at the read performance, so this is the latency on read queries. We have, in this case, once again, we are supporting five of those queries in this benchmark. We can see for the simple queries up to 15% and up to 50% for the more complex queries. This comes because, well, we have less pages that we need to analyze because we have our data more compressed, so we can effectively get performance improvements. We can see the same in the throughput, up to 70% for the more complex queries. And this is the third data set I was talking about, right? So in this test, which we were running, I think, 2 hours and a half, up to 3 hours, we're inserting 800 million samples into Redis time series. And we can see that the throughput, and effectively on the right-hand side, we can see the latency remain constant. So there's no degradation in that benchmark. It remains constant. Also integrations, so we Redis time series integrates with Prometheus. We have support for Telegraph, which is Influx, kind of like Prometheus solution. There's Grafana, which runs on top of Prometheus, but also you have a direct connection to Redis time series. And a small cliffhanger to come to the hackathon this evening, there might be something with Slack. How can I get started? So there's redistimeseries.io. And with that, I hand it over to Sharon, who's going to talk about Redis AI.
Afternoon, everyone, again. I know everyone is sort of sleepy, and no, I don't have any beer demos, sorry. But I try to make it, you know, really quick as possible. So we have gone through this already. Okay. How many of you haven't seen the slide in my last session? You haven't. How many of you haven't? Okay. So this is a simple pictorial representation of what Redis AI is. So Redis AI makes Redis database a deep learning deployment tool. It introduces something called a tensor data type to Redis database. And then you know, support four backends, PyTorch, TensorFlow, ONNX, and TensorFlow Lite. But one additional information that you probably need is with ONNX, you can essentially take a scikit-learn model or a XGBoost model or Apache Spark model, then convert it to ONNX using ONNX converter and deploy it to Redis AI. So essentially, Redis AI is not just a deep learning deployment tool, but you know, help you deploy a machine learning model as well. It runs on CPU, GPU, multi-GPU setup. Redis will automatically detect you will have a non-complicated method to determine what device your model should run on. It works with all the clustering master replica setup of Redis. And you know, makes your deep learning runtime scalable or highly available. Right. So the first and foremost thing that I love about Redis AI is how Redis AI makes your deep learning deployment easy. So deploying on Redis AI is essentially just one liner. So the four lines that I've given on the top are deployment setup. So if you look at the second word, that's the key that you know, that you are storing your model to in the Redis database. The third word, that's the backend that you want to use. So if you are setting up a TensorFlow model, you let the Redis know that it's a TensorFlow model by saying it's TF. And the fourth word is the device that you want to run your your model on. So if you look at the third line, Torch and GPU, right? So you're letting Redis knows that you want to run your model on the GPU rather than on CPU. Then you know the last part is where you pass your actual model, the binary file. So regardless of which backend or which device you have used or which you wish to use, the running setup is just this AI.modelrun. You specify which key where the model is being stored, and where the input is stored, and then where do you want to store the output, right? The second thing that I want to talk about today is the benchmarking suite that Felipe had made, Felipe from Redis Labs. So AI Bench, you could get this. So we have a link attached there. You could go to the slide and go to the GitHub of AI Bench. Currently, we are testing three deep learning solutions. One is just Redis AI. Second one is TF Serving plus Redis, and REST API plus Redis. So the reason why we have Redis there, is for proving how important is data locality. So since Redis AI is essentially built on top of Redis itself, the data locality by using the data locality, you can optimize your deep learning runtime executions. Current use cases supported, it's a credit card fraud detection from Kaggle, and two test cases. One is with the reference data. What I mean by reference data is in between your two executions, you will have a reference data. So output of first execution is required for the second execution. So you need to have some place to store that data. And that's what I meant by with reference data. And without reference data, we don't really care about what is the output of. Basically, different executions are completely independent. The suite is completely open source and easily extensible. So we can, anyone can go ahead and easily extend to, let's say, MXNet or MMS server or any other existing deep learning deployment solutions. Right. So this is a setup in the suite. You have a client, and for TensorFlow serving, you have Redis database there, which essentially helps you to store the intermediate data. And for a Flask REST API setup, you have a similar setup, but instead of TF serving, you have Flask there. Then in the Redis AI model server architecture has basically a benchmark client and just the Redis AI. Since Redis AI can serve TensorFlow or PyTorch model, that's just part of that in the picture. Right, so this is a solution. This is the performance that we have with the reference data. So if you look at the numbers here, right, in the REST API, it's a 5.5x performance gain if you are using Redis AI. And with TF Serving, which is supposed to be the industry's best deep learning solution right now, we are working 2.5x better. And I just want to make sure that you understand this 2.5x goes to 5x or 10x or 15x. Depends on how many reference data that you have in between different executions. Right. The next thing I want to talk about today is the MLflow integration that we have made. We are also working with Kubeflow to make a Kubeflow integration, but that'll probably be available in a month time or so. But MLflow is out. The PR is going to be merged soon. The seamless integration with MLflow ecosystem. So MLflow has already defined how the deep learning workflow should be. And a lot of people are using MLflow in their deep learning lifecycle. And we did not want to we did not want the developers to invest time on making this integration or changing their life cycle just because they wanted to use Redis AI. That's where the integration comes into the picture. So you can use the existing MLflow CLI. So if you look at the last line, MLflow models deploy. MLflow models is an existing CLI that has the new set of commands comes where MLflow picks Redis AI plugin, which is in the last line, MLflow Redis AI, and you know, deploy on ML, Redis AI when you mention with this. It goes with MLflow workflow, and it makes a single command deployment. And one of the major advantage of using this plugin is MLflow is already known for you know, making your lifecycle easy. So MLflow run dot will run the training loop. So I have, yeah, so this is, so if you look at the first line, MLflow run dot, that is essentially take the script and run your model, train your model, and save the model in the saved model format, which is the MLflow standard model in the disk. But you know, end of this line, you essentially get a run ID, right? So you can take that run ID, and the command that I've seen in the previous slide, MLflow models deploy, so you, that ID that's given there runs is essentially same as the ID that you get from after running the training using MLflow. So this will deploy the model to Redis AI. So there is a pre-processing that you have to do if you are deploying model by yourself, but that will be handled by the package that, the plugin package that we have made. So it essentially take that model, push it to Redis AI, and then this is where I'm running the inference on the on that model that we just deployed to Redis AI. So TensorSet is setting that tensor on INP key, and model run using inputs as INP and storing the outputs to out, and TensorGet is taking the values from out. Right. So this is where you could get Redis AI. The documentation and other details are available at redisai.io. Yeah, with that, I would like to conclude the talk. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you so much for, you know, listening to Guy, Petra, and me. Thank you.